So let's go finish with our last panel, the panel six, called Feminist Movements.
Thank you.
I leave with you to Rasha, who will be the moderator. Go ahead, Rasha.
Thank you so much. And I'm really inspired, and I learned a lot from all of the amazing previous panelists and speakers. It's so heartwarming to see all of us coming together from the different backgrounds and looking at an issue and looking at how can we all work together to find a solution collectively. It's just heartwarming. So our final panel is on the theme of feminist movements and leadership. And we all know how important feminist leadership is in our world to ensure that the voices of all are represented. I would like to invite my speakers, and we will start with Malene. So Malene, when we speak about women in leadership, aren't we supposed to ensure that these women leaders are also feminists? Why is it important in today's efforts to end gender inequality and build a more balanced, just world to ensure that feminist voices are leading our world? And also, please tell us more about the different roles of those in leadership and ending human trafficking. Let me just introduce Malene. I know that I did it the other way around. Malene is the founder of Women Lead Movement, and she is one of the Obama fellows. That's where we met. She's a fierce voice in Africa, mobilizing women to take leadership into their hands. And I'm really proud of all her amazing achievements lately, being named among so many different lists. Malene, please share with us your perspectives on the importance of feminist leadership and how can feminist leadership really transform the world, and why is it important in issues like human trafficking?
Thank you so much, Rasha. You know, you always give such controversial topics. You owe that for the last, because this is absolutely a controversial one, because there are wolves amongst the sheep, unfortunately. As activists, one thing in the gender equality space is one thing that we must remember. And that is that patriarchy is a system that is not only upheld by men, but it's upheld by men and perpetuated by women. And that is something that is very, very important for us to know, because the fact that we are talking or fighting for equal rights doesn't mean that all women in the world are in agreement with this goal. So when we talk about achieving gender parity, you know, as it pertains to women in leadership or women in political leadership, what do we say? Are we saying that we want 50% of those women just because they're women? Or should this 50% be feminist women leaders? Meaning that these are the kind of women that will represent us in parliaments, that will represent us as ministers, that will ensure that they promote, protect, and fulfill women's rights. That these are the kind of women that, for example, fight regressive and discriminatory laws and practices against women. These should be the women that, out of their own accord, without civil society forcing the hand of government, will stand up and say, there's a gap in the legislative system. We need to fill that gap. Why does it take civil society to march, to petition, to protest in order for governments to move if we are so progressive in terms of having more women in these political offices? I don't even know if I should celebrate the 25% of women currently in political office. Because out of the 25%, I'm not even sure who's feminist or who's not. Yeah. The way that we can determine whether or not these women in political office are progressive is, are they progressive in promoting women's rights? And the way things are looking now is absolutely dire. We need to understand one thing. These women currently in political office were elected through political parties led by men with patriarchal ideology. They toe the political line. And that is why it's so vitally important for us to form and establish more women-led or feminist political organizations, not only movements, political organizations that will contest elections. In that way, we are absolutely sure that the women that makes their way to parliament and that makes their way to the executive arm of the state are women that will actually truly represent our interests in those offices. So that is very important to note. So when you speak about where does change happen, I mean, there's various levels. It happens in government, it happens in private sector, it happens in the communities, it happens in civil society. How does it happen? It happens through laws, it happens through policies, it happens through practices, it happens through programs, education, advocacy, campaigning, different ways. But where does the power lie? It lies within the legislative arm of the state, where policies and laws are being formulated. Where else does it lie? It lies within the executive arm of the state, where these policies and laws now become practice. They are implemented and resources are allocated to make these policies, plans and programs a reality. That is where we want feminist leaders. That is where we want our women to be leaders in. Now, I'm a lawyer by profession. Russia didn't mention it. And the one thing that I always look at to determine how pathetic governments are is the data, the statistics. Currently, Africa has almost 10 million women and men that are, okay, mostly women, that are being human trafficked, okay? 8% of all the child sex trafficking in the world comes from Africa. Now, recently a global report came out, in fact, 2 weeks ago, a global report that says that Africa, there's no country in Africa that fully meets the standards, and these are minimum standards for the Trafficking Victims Protection Act. Africa is still dangling at the bottom of the food chain. There's various tiers. Tier one is sort of countries that's doing okay, they have laws and frameworks in place. Tier two is countries that's sort of making progress. Tier two with a watch list are countries that seems to be making progress. And then really at the bottom is the Middle East countries that has done absolutely nothing. Now there's a link. If you look at the political leadership and those in political office, whether they're in parliaments, they are men. Most of these countries that are not making progress are men. And there's very little woman leadership in those. And that is why there isn't progress. So bottom line is, we need to understand that human trafficking is a serious concern in Africa currently, based on the statistics. The fact that no one is taking this seriously, it's not only a drive of GBD, human trafficking is gender-based violence. It's a form of gender-based violence. It should be acknowledged as a form of gender-based violence, and it should be treated with the same seriousness as all the other forms of GBD. And the fact that African countries are not making progress tells you exactly what their attitude are with regards to this. They are not taking it seriously, and we need, obviously, to ensure that we get more of our people in there to push the narrative. Thank you very much, Russia.
Thank you so much, Malene. What a force. What a force. Goodness to you. I love it. I love the energy. Thank you so much. Moving on to Ksenia. Ksenia is the co-founder of Young Feminist Europe. She is also the guru of transformation. That's for me what I call her. Ksenia is also so Young Feminist Europe got also the leadership on the Action Coalition of Feminist Leadership. So that's why she's with us here today to talk to us about the importance of transformation and how intersectional feminist leadership can transform systems. And that would actually allow the integration of such marginalized issues to be integrated in such spaces. Ksenia, please, the floor is yours.
What an introduction, Russia, and thank you for that. And of course, I have to go after Malene, who is like so passionate. So I hope I can keep the energy up. I'm just, everything that I heard today, I feel like, what can I even add to that? Because it's incredible, the knowledge that is in the room, the experiences, this. So just the energy from this and being with you in the room is really wow. So thank you for adding me to the group and to share a bit. And I guess what I want to add, maybe from the Action Coalition theme and feminist movements and feminist leadership, is really what we are working on is also the intersectional approach. I think when we talk about anti-slavery or slavery as a global issue and as part of exploitation, we also still see the global differences and how colonial systems are still a reason of how these exploitative systems around the globe are still upheld. So taking a systemic approach to that and really shifting these systems of inequality on different levels is of course like a huge task, but it is something that we are all working on. And one part of that is of course this intersectional approach. And I think sometimes we, when we talk about taking an intersectional approach, people assume, oh, okay, it's diversity, and we use it very like as an equivalent to diversity, but it is really the acknowledgement of different intersecting systems of oppression. And we also focus, when we talk about intersectionality, very often about the individual dimension of discrimination, and forget to talk about the other dimensions of discrimination, which are structural, which are in our institutions. So we need to really start with the work when we talk about dismantling systems of oppression. We need to start within our institutions and do the changes within the people who work in the institutions. And I think another, and that's maybe also for this theme, and one of the key dimension is the historic dimension of systems of oppression, which is really how did these systems of inequality came into being, and how are they still upheld? And really mainstreaming this decolonial approach, epistemologies, and how knowledge is created around this. So I don't want to talk for too long. This is an input that I wanted to share when we talk about taking an intersectional approach. I think feminist leadership, for me, it's always important to differentiate it from female leadership, but Malena already made a very good point on this, and also acknowledge that feminist leadership is just a different type of leadership that breaks hierarchies, that really works on shifting power on all of these different levels. And maybe as a recommendation, we have heard it before, I think, in the context of gender equality and in the context of the Beijing Platform for Action, when we talk about human trafficking and anti-slavery or slavery, we often talk about this in the context of gender-based violence, of violence against women. And there are a lot of we heard that today. There, of course, that's one of the prominent things in context in which we have to discuss it. But sometimes, when we only discuss it in that context, it's sometimes policymakers forget that it is an economic issue, and we are not working on the root causes for it. So I think it is super important to have these conversations. We heard from all different types of topics today how this issue is relevant from for all themes. Sorry, I got the notice to wrap up. got a bit distracted.
No, thank you so much.
That's it. I think I have nothing to add to everything that was said today. So thank you so much for all these amazing insights.
Thank you so much for taking us on that little analysis. It's always good to hear from you. Next, but last but not least, Gabrielle Thompson is the executive director of Free for Life International, which is an organization that works with survivor and rescue operations, and also prevention and restoration. And she's only 31. She's amazing. She inspires me every day. I want to hear from you, Gabrielle. What needs to be done? What needs to be done to ensure that the voices of those who are neglected and marginalized, the voices of victims and survivors, actually make it to the decision-making tables where feminists and leaders should be sitting and including these voices? Over to you.
Thank you. Well, it has been such an honor to be with all of you here this morning. I mean, really, what a force we all are together. So thank you all for just being a part of this. And it's an honor to also have a voice in that as well. So to your question, Rasha, addressing and eliminating trafficking is crucial to achieving gender equality and human rights. But how can we do that if those that are survivors and the true experts are not represented in the leadership of the anti-trafficking movements? And it is our responsibility as feminists and female leaders who represent women and girls from across the world who have survived these harrowing experiences to be included. Excluding them from the process has and will continue to perpetuate obstacles towards our ultimate goal of global gender equality. Moreover, it is imperative for the principle of ensuring full inclusion and participation of women, and particularly victims of trafficking, at all stages of the peacemaking, stabilization, and the reconstruction process. This is also in line with the Security Council Resolution 1325. So, if we want to be progressive in promoting gender equality and fully include female leaders, survivors must be incorporated. So, I have four recommendations. The first one of the best ways to support women survivors is assisting them through their recovery, healing, and empowering them through resources and income generating activities and education. And from there, giving them a seat at the table to become leaders in the space of women leadership and anti-trafficking. Two, it is my expert opinion that all anti-trafficking organizations need to have survivor leadership in the form of at least an advisory role. This is already a guiding principle for best practices for us to operate within, but should also be a way that we as practitioners and researchers vet and hold accountability towards organizations we partner with and are able to gauge growth and movement here. Third, having survivors as leaders will help guide and refine programs for protection, prosecution, prevention, awareness, and rehabilitation, and will assist in forming better practices and protocols by allowing the survivors themselves to help craft solutions in this space. This will also give them an opportunity to lead the force for gender equality as we learn from their own experience and perspectives what are the most effective tools for full empowerment and equality. And four, by having survivor leadership, it increases our reliability as organizations, improves our services, and sharpens trauma-informed survivor-focused care. And if we want to help the women and girls that have been the most oppressed and experienced the worst sides of violence and aggression, then we must learn more about what actually works for the survivors, not just the practitioners and women that are passionate about fighting anti-trafficking. This can only be done through full inclusion for survivors to have a voice in leadership. So to quickly summarize, I know we're short on time, emphasizing survivor-focused women leadership is the perfect way to end this panel because it combines all areas discussed here today and exemplifies what we can do as leaders in the movement towards gender equality. Towards gender equality and ending human trafficking. There are so many ways to increase and incorporate feminist leadership, but when we look at how to have collective action and movement towards fighting human trafficking and modern day slavery, we must incorporate voices of female survivors. The reality is that survivor leadership is a vital aspect of this discussion that is still missing from female leadership in the human trafficking and gender equality movements. Here, all of us are as female leaders in this space, and the next step we can take as abolitionists is to incorporate the voices of the true experts, those that have endured and survived human trafficking.
Thank you so much, Gabrielle, for ending with that note. Centering the voices of the most vulnerable should be all our duties. Thank you so much. What an inspiring day. Super honored to have heard from all of you. Maybe we can have a few minutes to see if any of our attendees have any questions. I know that we are 3 minutes after time, so let's see if any of our attendees have any questions. Please put them in the chat box.
Would all panelists open their camera so we can take one last picture of everyone here? Yeah. So Mori, Pallavi, Esgi, Tokosile, if you could turn on your cameras. Okay, there we go. Pallavi, Esgi, Tokosile, perfect, thank you. There's Nicole coming in the picture.
Oh, yes, Nicole.
One, two, there we go, thank you. Thank you very much for all your participation and your wise words and everything that you have shared with us today. We will do the translation later in the recording so you can access what everything has been said in English and Spanish. And thank you once again to each of you.
Thank you so much, everyone. We appreciate your time and effort. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye. Next time. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Ciao. Thank you. Gracias. Thank
Bye.
You. Take care.
Bye.